Cristiano Ronaldo is the second most expensive FPL player. He's also the second most owned player in FPL. But after last weekend, when he was crisscross on the bench against Everton, should we criss-kiss goodbye? That's the question.
Yeah, I think probably we might be at that point now. It's a shame, really, isn't it? Because obviously came in, set the world on fire and changed FPL fundamentally as we were all kind of going, well, how do we budget for him? Do we take Salah out? Do we try and have all of these premium assets? But we're at a stage now where the fixtures for one of the other premium forwards in the game has suddenly taken a turn for the better. And with some slight doubts now about Ronaldo in terms of we've seen Solskjaer bench him once, could it happen again? Plus, the fixture change for Manchester United isn't ideal either. So, could be the right time. What do you think, Lee? Do you agree or do you think we should be... Well, because it is still Cristiano Ronaldo, isn't it?
It is still Cristiano Ronaldo. And we all said this a few weeks ago when he came into the league. Right, in any given game, it doesn't matter against the smaller, the so-called lesser clubs or the bigger clubs. In actual fact, if there was a player in the league who you'd say would up his game for the bigger games, it's this man right here. And he had a face of thunder when he came off against Everton, didn't he? So here he is. He's got 2 weeks to kind of stew on that a little bit. He's going to want to prove a point against Leicester, is my opinion. So if you are looking to sell him... I don't disagree with Sam. The fixtures do look difficult and I can see why people would make the move to Lukaku, but not this week. Leicester's defence is the fourth worst in the league for goals conceded. It's only, I think, they're worse than Norwich, Leeds and Newcastle, the only three that are worse. So this is not the week to sell Ronaldo, in my opinion.
But when we look at those fixtures, can you understand why managers are parting company? Because after Leicester, of course, look at that. Liverpool, Spurs and Manchester City are the next three, Sam.
Yeah, and actually, if you look at his record for Juventus, he didn't score as many goals, nearly as many goals against the big teams as he did against the lower opposition in the league. So I think the opportunities that he gets will be less in those matches. Now, that doesn't mean he won't return, but I do think that Ronaldo has less of an opportunity to haul in those games than, say, Lukaku does against the opposition he has. So when you're making tough FPL decisions, you're not necessarily selling Ronaldo because you don't think he's going to return at all, just that you think there are other players that could return more per match than he might.
You'd struggle to captain him, wouldn't you, in a lot of those? Maybe what for game week 12 we'd think about it. But outside of that, you're not going to captain him too much. And for a 12.6 as he's in the game, you want to be able to confidently put the armband on him every single week. And I don't think you would.
OK. Adding to the uncertainties, the number of other options that Ole Gunnar Solskjaer has within the Man United squad, a whole host of players, and that's only going to increase the competition, of course, when you get Marcus Rashford back from injury. Look at all the options there.
Yeah, and the schedule's pretty relentless as well, isn't it, for Manchester United? We've just seen their Premier League fixtures, but, of course, within that, you've got a couple of games, I think it's Atalanta in Europe as well. So the fixture schedule is really bad for Manchester United. And we've seen in previous seasons at Juventus, I think a lot of the rhetoric when he got benched against Everton was actually, can this guy play three games in a week? And he rarely did that at Juventus. So I hate to say Ronaldo's a bit of a rotation risk now, potentially, in the Premier League, but I think we're up into that sort of level.
All right, Sam, would you... Fernandes is just looming into view there. I think a lot of people thought that he was going to be slightly disappearing into the shadows with Ronaldo's arrival, but is it actually Fernandes is going to be the better long-term pick?
Could be, couldn't it? I mean, he's top for chances created across the course of the season so far, with 23. So he
still
is...
Still on pens?
Yes, and he has said that. He said that at the end of the Champions League game the other night. If there was a penalty, I was taking it this game. Apparently, Ollie will make a decision before the match as to which one's on it. So you don't have, as we thought you might with Ronaldo, penalties as a guarantee. So it's tough. And we have seen Rashford being back this week. He played in a behind-the-scenes fixture in midweek. So he is back. He's going to be available again soon. So between Rashford and Bruno, maybe we've actually got two other players there who might make a better pick than Ronaldo if you still want to stay invested in Manchester United over the next few weeks.
He scored in that game as well, didn't he? So who do you think that Rashford's return could be bad news for when we look at those Manchester United attacking options?
Well, I'm expecting Rashford to probably go wide left, actually. So it could mean that Pogba probably, I guess, reprises that role a little bit deeper, potentially. But the point remains, in FPL, one of the things we love is certainty of starts. And at 12.6 for Ronaldo, I don't necessarily think you can, you know, absolutely hang your hat on him starting every single week now with those options. Rashford coming into the game at 9.4, if he can shake off that injury and get a few starts under his belt, it could be interesting, but as Sam's already alluded to, in these fixtures that are coming up, you're probably not going to bet that much of your FPL budget on somebody that's just coming back from injury and into a difficult fixture run. So wait and see on Rashford.
What would your final decision be then on Ronaldo? Because neither of you own him at the moment, do you?
No.
No.
Neither of us own him, and he would. If I owned him, I would be selling him.
Well, Chelsea are heading into this international break at the top of the Premier League table, and their next few fixtures don't look too bad either. Firstly, it's against Brentford, then the current bottom three of Norwich, Newcastle and Burnley. So understandably, there is a lot of interest in their assets, particularly Romelu Lukaku. But Sam, three blanks in a row now. As someone who's gone for Lukaku on your wildcard team, how are you feeling about him?
I actually don't feel too bad about it because he has been really unlucky not to score in those three game weeks, particularly in game week 7. He was top for XG underachievers, meaning that he should have scored in that game were it not for the post and some offside decisions he would have done. It was the same against Spurs. He was really unlucky not to score against them. There's been opportunities for Lukaku, and those opportunities will continue to go because that Chelsea side, particularly in their wing-backs, are being incredibly creative. So we will see that continue. And over this fixture period that they have, they're going to come up against less promising defences than we've seen in the last couple of weeks. So it's annoying that he hasn't returned for the last three, but he's still captainable over the next few weeks.
Really,
he still looks good.
Haven't really seen him get the service, though, have we, in the last three? That's the thing about the way Chelsea have played. He's looked a little bit isolated at times in those last three games without the returns. However, I'm expecting the return of Mason Mount to have a big impact on how Lukaku scores in terms of FPL points. I think Tuchel's been out in the press talking about the fact that Lukaku's got a really good relationship, mental on the pitch relationship with the likes of Kovacic and Mount, and some of the other players, the midfielders, are kind of catching up with that. So with Kovacic and Mount both in there, and Mount in particular coming back from his injury, I'd expect Lukaku to do a lot better.
OK, and Lukaku, unlike, say, Ronaldo, is pretty much nailed on to start. He's played every single minute since arriving at Stamford Bridge. Is that a big factor in deciding which, maybe, of the premium forwards to go for?
Yeah, I think so. I don't see Lukaku being rotated, but in the potential way that Cristiano might. And he's going to cost you 0.9 less as well. Whoa. So you've got to think about what you might do with that extra million in the rest of your team. So, yeah, I think if I was going to straight choice between the two, I think I'd go for Big Rom at the minute.
In defence, 730,000 managers bought in Marcus Alonso. So, of course, that means that he didn't feature for the first time this season. Ben Chilwell back in. How concerning is that for Alonso owners, do you think, Sam?
I think it is concerning because actually Chilwell had a good game. Made a mistake in the first half, but then, of course, kept the clean sheet. Got the goal in that game. So that makes a big difference. And he was full of confidence again. You could see him towards the end of that game really coming back into the Chilwell that we used to love in FPL last season. It does worry me in terms of Alonso. So when I was trying to decide on a Chelsea defender last week, I stayed clear of both of them because I just wasn't sure what to do. And the straight choice came between Rudiger and Aspilicueta for me. And, of course, I went with the wrong one, as it happened last week, because I went Rudiger and it was Aspilicueta. But I think I would be avoiding both of these two right now until we get more certainty over who's getting the nod, because we could just see them get rotated over the season.
Yeah, I mean, as an Alonso owner myself, what kind of split do you think we'll be getting?
What a good question that is. I don't know. I mean, I must admit, I was surprised to see Chilwell start against Southampton. I mean, Chelsea have had some difficult...
Alonso's been so good.
Well, he's been great, and they've had some difficult fixtures, so I understand maybe Tuchel might not want to play Alonso in some of the more difficult fixtures, but he did.
Yeah.
So here we are against Southampton last game week. I think, well, surely Alonso starts then, because he's going to carry on with that kind of, you know, free reign down the left-hand side, but doesn't. Chilwell comes in. So I can't answer the question. I'm not in Tuchel's head in terms of what sort of game time these two are going to get. But what I will say is that if you did go Alonso, you knew that this was coming, right? We know that Chilwell's in the background looking and pressing for a start. So now you've got a bit of a headache to overcome, I'm afraid, Alonso owners.
There you go.
Let's take a look at some of the other Chelsea defensive options then, because Rudiger has been very popular. Aspilicueta, as you mentioned, big scorer last week. And, of course, Reece James. How are you feeling about these three, other than full of regret for not bringing Aspilicueta?
Yeah, full of regret. No, actually, I'm still not full of regret, because I do think of all of them, Rudiger is the most safe. He was the safe Chelsea pick. And with the fixtures coming that they have, that's what I wanted. I wanted a secure player that was going to play every week and therefore be able to get those clean sheets. I think Aspilicueta is also in that category of being relatively safe because he can play multiple positions across that defensive unit and, of course, is the captain, so that makes a big difference. So, for me, it will be these two. I really like Reece James, but we have seen him benched, we have seen him injured, and we don't really know how long this injury is going to be for. He's withdrawn, obviously, from the England squad. So let's wait and see on him. I think for the fixtures the way that they are, going with Rudiger or Aspilicueta makes a lot of sense.
OK. I mean, do we now have to treat Chelsea the way we have been for seasons now? Man City, in terms of the turnover risk and the fact that you go for players who are not producing as much, but because they are going to actually start. Tuchel tombola. Do we have to factor that in now?
I think you do. Yes, when you're picking any from any player in FPL, you've got to consider the rotation risk.
But and particularly I think with at these clubs.
Yeah, and I think the Chelsea rotation at the back, they've got so many options, haven't they now, Thomas yeah. Tuchel? I hear what Sam's saying before. I think certainly Rudiger looks like the most safe, but you do take a chance.
And you see there the stats. Only Arsenal have used more players so far this season. Watford right up there as well, actually. Kelly, but yeah, so from Chelsea's point of view, you're better off with the safer picks than, say, the Alonsos who've been firing so well in the early weeks.
I think if you want to be sure that they're going to start, and right. if you're taking some chances elsewhere in your team, then going with Rudiger feels like a really nice... We've seen he's got goal threat. He scored already this season. So it's not like you're sacrificing all attacking threat if you go Rudiger, but you are gaining that slight peace of mind that you don't necessarily get with some of the others.
Fair enough.
What's all nice, right. though, this season, sorry to butt in, James, but what's nice is we've got Tino Livramento there, haven't we,
yes.
from Southampton. So if any of your Chelsea players that you've picked don't start at the back, he comes in off your bench, so get him in.
Time now for some ones to watch. And we picked out some clubs with pairs of appealing assets. So to give you an example, let's start with Wolves, where you've got Huang and Jimenez. Now, they both returned double digits in game week 7, Lee. Mm. There's a massive price difference between the two, almost 2 million. Which have you got? Who are you happy with? Actually, Sam, I think you had Jimenez, you mentioned before, who returned big time. You're pretty happy with that.
Oh, I'm absolutely delighted to own Jimenez. But if I was wildcarding, I'd probably go Huang. Ooh. He's got the best goal conversion rate in the league right now, 60%. So he's doing really well. Not only that, his relationship with Jimenez has really developed in the last couple of weeks. And we've seen that he's now regularly starting. The chatter in the Wolves community suggests that that's going to continue over the next few weeks as well. And I think if you can save that level of budget and still, you know, guarantee a starter, that's worth doing. They remind me a little bit of Son and Kane last season, in that Jimenez is dropping slightly deeper and he's sending the ball into Huang, which means that you're likely to get more assists from Jimenez, but increases the goal threat from Huang. So both of them nice appealing options. Actually, nothing wrong with necessarily going with both of them.
Wow. Wolves double up.
That's quite a bold move, isn't it, for a team that haven't scored too many goals this season. How are you feeling about these two?
Yeah, they haven't scored too many goals, but their expected goals is quite high. I think they should have scored six more than they have, if that makes sense. So their expected data is pretty good. So I think Sam's right to have Jimenez and absolutely stick there. I like Huang, actually. And if we look back over the previous kind of couple of seasons, whoever's partnered Jimenez in FPL and at Wolves has done pretty well. So Diogo Jota's done pretty good there. Adama Traore and Jimenez had a great relationship, didn't they, last year? So if Huang can be, you know, Jimenez's Robin to his Batman, if that's the right analogy, which is probably not, then maybe we'll see some points for Huang as well. And at that price, 5.6, then he's not exactly a risk, is he?
Let's look at a couple of Arsenal midfielders now then, because these are the two we've picked out. And you actually went for Saka over Smith Rowe. Now, are you happy with that decision?
Yeah, I still think Saka's the one to have. I think I've cast our minds back to the summer when he played for England. He was so good in that European Championship, wasn't he? And I think he's got he had a little bit of a false start early on in the season, as did a lot of as did Arsenal, quite frankly. And I think that was mainly because he missed out on quite a bit of that pre-season. So he's had a little bit of a rest, inverted commas, you know, a bit of an injury. He's just shaking that off. He came back into the side, I think, 3 game weeks ago, got back-to-back returns in FPL. So the fact he's got a blank last week, not too concerned about that. He's a little bit more expensive than Smith Rowe, which bothers me a little bit, but I still think I'm happy having him.
How are you feeling about these two, Sam? Because Smith Rowe's price went up overnight, which suggests that a lot of managers are jumping on him.
I'd have gone Smith Rowe over Saka, actually, which is where we would differ on this. I really like Smith Rowe. I think he's really exciting to watch, and he seems to find a space for him in the starting 11 all the time. He never really seems to be risked or rotated. I think Smith Rowe could have a really good season this year, and because he's that much cheaper, I think that makes him a really viable option.
Brilliant. If you want Matt returns, then Aston Villa have got two of them, Matt Cash and Matt Target. Now, they both play wing-back. They've both had 3 clean sheets in the last 7 for Villa. Which one should you use your cash to target?
Very good, James. I would use my cash on cash, actually.
Oh, right, okay.
The couple of games that I have watched Aston Villa recently, really passing the eye test for me, crossing in from that side, very, very good. And actually creating a lot of chances for Matt Target coming in on the other side. So he's the one I think I would have, and I think he's a pretty low-owned, maybe less than 5% differential as well. So
right.
I would go for Matty Cash.
Matty Cash, Sam?
Yeah, actually, having watched them, I went to the game last weekend, having watched them live, I was really impressed by Cash. He was in all the right places, doing all the right things. So, yeah, I'd go Cash as well.
All right.
Let's talk about Villa forwards now then, because everyone was very excited about Danny Ings signing for Aston Villa at the start of the season. He's now gone five without a goal. Ollie Watkins got his first goal of the season against Spurs on Sunday. Lee, you started the season with Ings. Any temptation to get him back?
No, not really. No, if I was going to go in on one of these two guys, it would absolutely be Ollie Watkins at the minute. I think my fear at the beginning of the season was actually if Danny Ings comes into Aston Villa, maybe Watkins goes out left, he hugs the touchline, he gets chalk on his boots, and therefore, from an FPL perspective, he's going to be less in those positions to get points. Not the case. He's spending far more time in and around Danny Ings. They're playing much more as a two. And if anything, it's Ings that's kind of dropping back in that kind of Kane stroke, Jimenez stroke, Firmino role and creating the assists and creating the chances for Mr. Watkins. So he's the one to have, I think, Ollie.
And I bet that's paining you to say a little bit, because I know that Sam's been saying for a few weeks now that Ollie Watkins is the man to have.
Yeah, and he's one that I really wish I did have. So he actually beats Ings hands down in all of the key categories. So for goal attempts, Watkins has 13, Ings has 8. For shots on target, Watkins has 7, Ings has 4. For big chances, Watkins has 3, Ings has 1. And Watkins has played 2 games less. And you saw in that game against Spurs, as Lee rightly said, he is the one that is in those attacking positions. They are together, but it's still Watkins that they're all looking for. And you can feel the relationship is already existing. He is going from strength to strength. And he's cheaper. At that price, I think he's really good value.
Can I just ask, because you've been saying for a few weeks about him, but you haven't got him in your team, have you?
No, only because I haven't wanted to lose Antonio. So it's been that player that's in the spot that I've kind of been like, ugh. But actually, I think within the next couple of weeks, I can see myself going Antonio to Watkins. I can feel it coming. It's just a time factor.
Well, we'll finish off with one more pair of rivals from a single club, Everton, where you've got Dominic Calvert-Lewin and Richarlison, both poised to come back into the picture. They're both low ownership, less than 5%. What do you think? Would you go for either of these two? And if so, which, Lee?
Well, I still think I would go with Dominic Calvert-Lewin, who I have owned for a couple of game weeks this season before the injury. I'm kind of interested to see how these two come back in and affect some of the mid-price midfielders that we're going to look at a bit later on.
Right.
But for me, I think I would still go with DCL, and I think he's still on penalties as well.
DCL, Sam?
Yeah.
DCL.
You would love a team of just forwards, wouldn't you?
I would, and that's the problem, isn't it? You can only have three, and you've got to make some tough choices. But yeah, of these two, it's Calvert-Lewin.
FPL powerhouses. I'm going to start with Jamie Vardy. Good Lord, he's had 6 goals in 7 games this season, and that's without even taking any penalties yet. Only Salah and Antonio have more points than him, but it says here he's not even among the top 25 most owned players. Why is this, Sam?
Because he's 10.5 million.
Yeah, and but that's less than...
Yeah. But that's the problem, isn't it? Because, you know, you're talking about owning Salah and Lukaku or Ronaldo, and you're probably going to want Trent Alexander-Arnold. So to fit in a over £10 million player is difficult, particularly when there have been so many good budget options. You know, we've already spoken about Watkins and Jimenez that are so much cheaper.
Right.
That's why he's lowly owned, but he's a great differential.
That makes a lot of sense. And that's why I think most of us went for Lukaku's or Rons or both and not Vardy. But he's outscored those other two.
Yep.
So now that we've seen what we've seen, should we be actually slipping it in reverse and going back and picking up Jamie?
Yeah, I mean, when you look at the last 2 game weeks, he's 2nd for goal attempts with 9. And over the course of the whole season, he's 3rd for goal attempts among forwards. So definitely he's getting in the right places. He's doing the right things. I think there was some concerns at the beginning of the season about the creativity around him, because at the end of last year, it was his relationship with Iheanacho that was so potent for FPL managers. Whereas with Barnes back, it's taken a little bit of time to see it.
Last game week, Iheanacho playing up front alongside him. And would you get him, briefly? Would you get him?
No, I can't afford him. That's the problem.
You also can't have another forward.
I can't have any more forwards.
Let's talk about a couple of other big hitters now. And 2 City midfielders got their first goals of the season last time out. Kevin De Bruyne and Phil Foden. There's just the call, £4 million between these two. Which one would you go for? Would you go for either? I know with City there is, of course, the risk of rotation.
Of course. It's got to be this man, isn't it? I mean, how good was he against Liverpool?
He was so good.
I mean, Kevin De Bruyne, actually, I thought was a little bit sloppy in that first half. I think he was, of all of the Man City midfielders, the one that looked a little bit like he was a bit off the pace, needed a couple of games to get going. But it's Kevin De Bruyne. He will eventually start returning for us. Again, the price point is pretty restrictive. Of course, you can't have him and Salah and Lukaku and everybody else that you want, right? But at 7.9... you can find a slot, I think, for Phil Foden. And I genuinely think this is the season, I feel like I've said this last couple of seasons, this is the season where I think he comes of age a little bit and starts to get regular starts in that City team. He clearly is an important cog in Pep's machine, as he showed against Liverpool. So at 7.9, I'd have him out of these two.
What about you, Sam? Would you have either? It does feel like 11.9, although we all know what Kevin De Bruyne is capable of, without only having scored one goal so far, it does feel a bit of a risk, doesn't it?
Yeah, I mean, his route to points is great because, you know, we've seen him be on penalties in the past, obviously on set pieces. But with Foden, since he's returned from his injury, he's been the most creative Manchester City midfielder for both expected goals and expected goal involvement. So from that perspective, he is doing everything right. And at the price that he is, he's going to allow you to have these other players, you know, the likes of Vardy, if you want to go there. If you've got somebody in at that price point, it's going to be much easier to do. Whereas with De Bruyne at 11.9, it's a really tough budget. And we haven't yet seen the best of him yet, whereas I feel like we're already starting to see the best of Foden. So you go with the form and go with Foden.
Mm, all right. A Spurs question for you, Sam. Son Heung-min has been ticking along quite nicely amidst the various problems there at Tottenham. He's had, what, 42 points so far, which is a whopping 31 more than Harry Kane has had. If you're looking to free up a bit of cash elsewhere, or if you've got a bit of cash coming up and you'd like to upgrade someone in your midfield, is Son a player you should be going for?
Yeah, if I was wildcarding this week, I would bring Son in on the basis that he has been, the last couple of games in the Premier League and, of course, in the Conference, we've seen Son being back to the happy, smiley Son. He's in the right positions, he's doing the right things. Goal threat is definitely there. Kane's dropping deeper again, sending balls into him, which is boding well for what we might see from him. Again, the price is difficult because you've got to find a way to probably get up from the likes of Greenwood to get to Son. But if you've got the budget to do it, he will be a fantastic differential over the next few weeks, particularly against Newcastle in Game Week 8.
Oof. What about goalkeepers now then? Could this be the year to invest in a premium goalkeeper with rotation in defence? Are any of these three good options? Because pretty much guaranteed to start.
They're pretty much guaranteed to start, yeah. I mean, careful with Alisson because I think he's travelling with Brazil, so therefore may not be available for Game Week 8. Mendy, we've seen Kepa come in a couple of times, haven't we? But I think Mendy's pretty safe. And of course, Edison safe as houses at 6 million. And the Man City defence, and that's why out of these three, I would go for him if I was going to go for a premium goalkeeper. The Man City defence is absolutely stat-busting everything right now in terms of shots on target, conceded, in terms of the areas that the opposition are getting into. They are defending so well, Manchester City. Now, don't get me wrong, there's great defensive options from all of these clubs as well. But if you were going to go for a premium keeper, I think it'll go Edison.
So, Watford have a new manager, Cisco Munoz, departing the club on Sunday. Claudio Ranieri is now in the hot seat there. And this is going to be interesting for us FPL managers. Watford have three players with over 10% ownership. Only Chelsea, Liverpool, Man City and Man United have more than that. Let's take a look at their fixtures because they do take a slight turn. Ooh. Having had a nice run, there is a lot of pink in there playing both Merseyside clubs. Of course, Lee, first up, your Liverpool. If you do have Watford players, is now the time to sell? Or do you think Claudio Ranieri could give them some miracle or form of lease of life going into these fixtures?
With those fixtures, he is going to need a bit of a miracle, isn't he, Ranieri, coming into this? I think we're all expecting Ranieri to be a little bit more defensive-minded, if anything. So there are some FPL assets like Ben Foster in goal at 4.0 million, who's a good option. But he does need to sort them out defensively. No clean sheets so far for Everton, and also 37 attempts conceded from set plays. So that's a key area that I think Ranieri is going to need to address. Now, coming into that Liverpool fixture, Liverpool are one of the best in the league at set pieces. And sorry to reel out this rhetoric, Kelly, but I am looking forward to the corners and direct free kicks that we might get against your lot next weekend.
Enjoy that.
Ismail Assar, there's about 1.5 million managers out there, and there's one of them in here, certainly, who have Ismail Assar. But looking at those fixtures there, what would you say to managers with Assar?
Time to sell.
Really?
Yeah, I think with Sarr, he was the perfect player for a couple of weeks ago. Had a couple of nice fixtures. He was in a great purple patch, but they're not creating, really, and anywhere near enough opportunities. And they're coming up against some really difficult defences. Even that fixture in there that is green against Southampton, that is a tough defence at the moment to play against. We've seen that in the last couple of weeks. So I don't think he's going to get that many opportunities going forward. I think Ranieri's going to come in and work on the defence. He's going to work on strengthening, tightening up, getting back to what Watford were good at in the Championship, and that's being a solid defensive unit, which might mean less attacking returns for the likes of Saar. And I think given the fixtures and the fixture swings the way that they are for other clubs right now, you're better off to move to one of those midfielders.
Sam's not telling me what I want to hear, Lee. What about you?
Is he in your team then, Jay?
He is in my team.
Yeah, well, I think they've created 8 big chances so far this season, Watford, and 6 of them came in that single game against Norwich, where, of course, Ismaïl Assar did very well. We all piled in. But I think Sam's absolutely right. They are not really creating the volume of chances that we look for in FPL. So don't get me wrong, I love the player. I think Ismaïl Assar's a really fantastic young player. But probably it's time to sell, I'm afraid, James.
Ooh.
I'll give you this. The last time Watford played Liverpool at Vicarage Road, Lee will remember it well. 3-0, and Ismaïl Assar was brilliant in that game, so you never know. Let's talk the Watford keepers now then, shall we? Because there is a bit of doubt as to who will be in goal. Dan Backman started the season, then Ben Foster has come in. But who will start under Claudio Ranieri? We aren't quite sure. And Backman has seen his price fall to $4.4 million this week as well. Should we be considering either of these, or maybe not with those fixtures?
So I think Ben Foster could be a good option here because he is currently, or was, in game week 7 playing when Backman was available. So he had the choice and he went with Foster. Now, obviously, it's a new manager. We're yet to see what he does. But Foster is the experienced goalkeeper amongst these two. And if you want to strengthen up, he's got Premier League pedigree and we've seen that in the past. 4 million, you could have him as a second goalkeeper easily. You could pair him up with the likes of Raya at Brentford, who's 4.6 right now, and have two really cheap playing first choices. It's no guarantee Foster's going to be playing, but I think he's worth a shout.
Okay. Any other Watford players who might come into the picture? You've got Sissoko, who looks locked in as a $4.5 million midfielder. Dennis is still really cheap. What about Josh King as well?
Yeah, well, I'm expecting Josh King to lead the line. I think he's a very Ranieri-style player.
Right.
But I think if you've got Dennis, and I understand why you'd have him because of the budget factor up front, I think we've talked about Hwang and others. I think there are better options now in that price bracket than Dennis. I'm not expecting him to get perhaps as much game time under Ranieri as he has so far this season. But a bit of a lottery, I think. So many options to go for in Watford. But I think it'll be Josh King that leads the line.
Just a bit of fun. I've always done it with my family, with the boys when I was at Palace. There's always just a bit of banter. Normally quite good at it, so yeah, I enjoy it. I never pick myself. I just don't want to jinx it, but all my family, obviously, they're loyal to me, so I'm always in their team. So normally in previous seasons, it's gone against them, but this season, they're a lot closer to me in the table because obviously I'm producing the goods and I'm getting goals, I'm getting assists. So yeah, I may have to take the plunge and put myself in to cover myself against my other family members. I know what I'm capable of. I know I'm capable of double figures, but for one reason or another, I've never hit double figures in my career. So I just have to take it a game at a time. Every time I step on the pitch, look to do the right things, look to get into the right areas and feature a lot more regularly on the goal scoring sheet and the assist list as well. Honestly, I don't know. There wasn't a obviously when Dominic and Richie are back fit, they're number one and two, but the fact that they weren't on the pitch, the manager didn't designate a penalty taker. I was first to the ball. Dimi tried to have a word. I had the ball in my hand and I took it and I scored. I think Dimi's price has shot up. I think he's, if I'm not mistaken, he's 5.8 now. The value for money has to be in the cheaper option, myself and Dukes, although Dimi has scored a lot of goals. So it's whether you want somebody who scored more goals or you want to save a few pennies. I think it's your decision at the end of the day. It's a player that I've always had, whether he's scoring goals or not scoring goals, and that is Harry Kane. Always, because he may go through droughts, he may not score for a few games, but at the end of the season, he's always going to get you 20 to 25 goals. And people fluctuate; they sell him when he's not playing well. They buy into the media hype, but I know that eventually he's going to start scoring. He's going to start scoring bucket loads. So he's always in my team, whether he's scoring goals or not.
Budget mids, everybody. We're going to have a look now at some cheap and cheerful midfielders. And let's start off with no less than 3 of them. A triple helping of Toffee there from Everton. Doucouré, Townsend and Gray, they all started off the season at 5.5 million. As you can see, they've all gone up in price, particularly Gray there, who's a whopping 5.8 now. Who have you got out of these three, Sam and Lee? And who would you advise people to get?
So I've got Damari Gray. So despite no points at Old Trafford, I was still pretty impressed with his performance. So no panic there, I don't think, on Gray. He's having a very good season. But I can see why a lot of FPL managers would be going to Townsend, particularly with the set pieces. He took the penalty, although I don't think he's going to be on penalties, as we saw in the previous VT, when Dominic Calvert-Lewin and Richarlison come back.
Right.
But all three of them good picks. They've had a great start to the season.
Sam?
Yeah, I mean, I also own Gray, but if I wasn't invested in Everton right now, I would be tempted to go Townsend instead, save a little bit of budget. I have some slight concerns about Townsend when we have the return of Richarlison and Calvert-Lewin and where he might be positioned on the pitch. Same with Decore. I suspect we might see Decore drop a bit deeper, as we have seen in the earlier part of the season, which means maybe Gray is the right one to be on. So for now, happy to hold him.
Okay.
So we know they've had a brilliant start to the season. Let's just put this into context then for you, because these are the top scorers so far this season. They are up there 6th and 7th with 43 points apiece. That just shows, doesn't it, the company they're keeping at that price point makes them even more attractive.
Absolutely. And I think, you know, the fixtures are still quite nice for Everton. They're not that bad for a little while yet. So holding them is really, it's advisable, really, when you think about how much they're going to cost. They're going to free up budget. It's going to allow you to have some of those other premiums.
OK. Another player who's appealing in that price tag is Brian Mbeumo, who's been, I think, the most unlucky player in the Premier League so far this season. He's hit the woodwork, four times already?
Four times,
yes.
Yeah.
Four times. All right. It's got to come good for him, surely. And that 5.5 price tag makes him very appealing.
He's so good, yeah. He's so good. I think if you're playing your wild card this week and you're thinking, actually, I'm not going to go in on Brentford because they've got this Chelsea fixture coming up, just have a look at what happens after Chelsea. The fixtures are really, really good. So having either this guy or Ivan Toney in your team looks pretty good. I was so impressed with them both, actually, in the recent Liverpool game, that 3-3 to Barnstorm. What a great game. But you're right, James. Had those four efforts that Mbeumo took gone in rather than hit the woodwork, we'd be talking about him being at the top of that list we just had on the screen here. So
incredible.
Looks great for the next few weeks.
Wow.
Would you rather have Ivan Toney? Are you worried about this and maybe taking some of Mbeumo's game time?
Possibly, although the way that Mbeumo and Toney are playing together and the relationship they've got, I think he's got to go with those two. Toney, I think, has got the penalties, probably a bit more clinical in terms of his finishing, but I think you get a bit of creativity with Mbeumo as well in terms of assist potential. So tough one to call.
All right, let's have a look at three more budget options. All very popular choices. Rafinha, Benrahma and Gallagher. Have we all got Benrahma?
No.
What?
Out.
Just us.
Just us two. All right, so who have the experts got out of these three?
So I've got Rafinha, and I think you have as well, right?
No, I have none of these, actually, currently.
Really?
Yeah, none of them at the moment, but Gallagher is 100% on my list of potential ins this week.
Uh-huh.
I think with the exception of the Arsenal game that they've obviously got in Gameweek 8 and then a game against Manchester City in Gameweek 10, the fixtures are beautiful for Crystal Palace. He's been so creative. He's 8th for threat amongst midfielders in the game right now in the ICT index. So he's doing all the right things. He's had so many opportunities, and if he could have just finished them, we've been talking about him in that same price bracket that we were before with the points totals that they had. So I'm suspecting that Gallagher's going to have a really good season, and he's one, if I was wildcarding, would 100% be in. And even without a wildcard, I still think I might bring him in this week.
Tell us, why don't you have Benrahma? Myself and James as owners are desperate to know.
Well, I think he got off to a fantastic start to the season, didn't he? But then in the last three or four games, OK, he got the goal, didn't he, a couple of weeks ago. But it's a big deflection that kind of got him the goal. So a little bit lucky from that perspective. And his underlying stats have just dropped off a little bit. So given the plethora of options we've got in this bracket, and there are loads of them, three great ones on the screen here, I just think there's better options than Benrahma.
You love him, don't you?
I do love Rafinha a lot. Great player. Really, really good. Yeah.
All right, if you have to pick one of these budget midfielders that we've talked about, just one, which would it be, Sam?
It's Mbeumo for me.
Who, sorry?
Mbeumo, followed by Gallagher, yeah.
OK, and what about you, Lee?
I'd go for my boy Rafinha. I'll stick with him, yeah. Be careful, though. He might not be back from international duty in time for Game Week 8, so keep an eye on that one, but he'd be my pick.
OK, now, Sam and Lee, you guys have both played your wild cards. Mm. Myself and James haven't, so let's take a look at the teams that you have put together. Sam, we'll start with you. If you were wildcarding, this is the squad that you would go for.
Yeah, I really tried to budget for Sun in this one. I couldn't quite get there.
Yeah, of course.
Hence, Lucas Moura is there. I was about a million short because there is some money in the bank with this team. Raya and Foster in goal, I think that makes a lot of sense with the Brentford fixtures. Might take a hit in game week 8 because they've got difficult fixtures, but after that, it looks nice. And then I think you have to go Trent plus a Liverpool plus a Chelsea, plus a Chelsea and a City in defence, and Livramento is the perfect pick to go alongside them because he's so cheap. some differentials in the middle then with Rafinha, who obviously Lee likes as well, but Mbeumo and Gallagher, I think, could be really nice. And Lucas Moura's there because Spurs have got Newcastle in game week 8, and I think they could exploit that defensive line. And then up top, it was a real struggle because Jimenez and Antonio, I really flip-flop when you asked me to do this between the two of them. I think Watkins could have come in for Antonio, Lukaku and then Jimenez, one of them four.
Keepers as well. Interesting. You've stuck with Foster and Raya as well.
Yeah, because I think when you look at the Brentford fixtures moving forward after Chelsea, they're really nice. And if you're wildcarding, you don't want to be making keeper changes at a later date. You want to fix your keepers in on wildcards. So, yes, the fixture in Game Week 8 isn't great for either of them because they've got Chelsea and Liverpool. But other than that, you just play Raya for the rest of the period of time.
Sam, you mentioned that putting in Lucas Moura because they've got the Newcastle game. When you're wildcarding, how big a body of fixtures would you want to base your decisions on?
Well, I mean, the reality with the rest of this squad is that they're based up until Christmas with nice runs of fixtures. So to having a position where you take a chance feels OK. Like Lucas Moura, if you keep him for a couple of game weeks and then swap him out for somebody else, that's fine because the rest of the team, barring injury, you don't need to necessarily do anything to.
James is contemplating the wild card as we speak.
Yeah, he does this every week. It's just an act. He still hasn't played it. And what formation would you play with this group of players?
So I think if you're going with the three big boys up top, you have to play three up top, which means you're some weeks going to go 3-4-3 and some weeks you're going to go 4-3-3.
All right. It's amazing team.
Taking a mental photo.
I'm tempted. Lee, let's have a look at your wild card draft. Will this sort me out until Christmas as well?
this will do you for a few weeks, James. Yeah, no Lucas Moura, unfortunately. But outside of that, I've downgraded Saka, who's currently in my team, to Smith Rowe, so that I could free up a bit of cash to get Tony up top there. And I hear what Sam's saying about Brian and Bremo. Great pick, I think. Could there be a case for going for both of those guys, actually? Tony and Mbeumo, the fixtures are that good after Chelsea. I think you could make a case. But I'm going to go with the talisman. I'm going to go with Tony. No change with Lukaku and Antonio up front. And then as Sam's done, I think pretty similar at the back there. I think we might even have the same back line. I'm tapping into the Chelsea stability and the sort of safety of starts with Rudiger and then having a slight rotation risk for Cancelo, although I don't necessarily see that as a big risk. But if I was going to go into one on each of those, one Chelsea and one Man City, that's how I'd do it. I'd have one non-risky and one slightly riskier. Trent, of course, is in there. And then White and Livramento are the two budget picks. So nice rounded team for you there, James.
It is very nice, actually. Speaking of risks, though, you've got three Arsenal players. I don't know if you noticed.
Yes, I did notice that. That was the first thing when I sent this to the producer, I sort of sent the eyes wide emoji, three Arsenal players. But listen, that's where I'm just tapping into some value there with Smith Rowe, White and Ramsdale. You know, none of those are going to cost you more than 5.3 for, you know, some FPL point-scoring Arsenal players who seem to have found a bit of form. So I'm happy with them.
About Diogo Jota, I know you're a Liverpool fan. Has that clouded your judgment here? Or are you still convinced that even with Roberto Firmino back, he's going to get regular starts, regular game time?
I think Firmino will take some of his minutes, but I think as we saw in the previous game week, and Firmino's not quite up to speed yet, right? And he's gone away with the internationals. So I think Jota's going to be OK for next week. But his underlying stats are ridiculous for a 7.6 million midfielder. He's right up, he's not right up there with Salah and Mane, but he's kind of next tier down above pretty much everybody else in terms of shots on target and the positions he's getting in. So at 7.6, even if he comes off the bench in that Liverpool side, who are having so many shots, so much attacking output, I think it's great value still. So I'd be holding on to him.
All right, we're going to start with Aboubakar Ibrahim, who is looking at Man United's fixtures and saying, should I sell Fernandes at 11.9 and bring in Kevin De Bruyne? What do you think, Sam?
Sell Fernandes, yes. Probably bring in Foden, actually, just save yourself a load of money because I'm not convinced that KDB is quite at that 11.9 stage yet, and that money could do you well across the rest of your team that you're going to save. But Bruno has been the most creative player in the game so far, most chances created, so maybe actually he is one you could hold, but the fixtures aren't very nice, so I'd probably go to Foden instead, actually.
Lee?
Yeah, I tend to agree with Sam, actually. Fernandes, just a little bit off the boil, isn't he? Only averaged 3 points per game in the last 3 or 4 weeks, so he's probably a sell, and I agree. I'm not sure I'd go Kevin De Bruyne. There's a lot you can do with 11 million, but I think give Kevin De Bruyne a few weeks.
OK, moving on to our next tweet, and this one concerns Ferran Torres at Manchester City. Should Bal said, should I go with him or no, Torres? 6.9 million, his price has gone down to now. Sam, how are you feeling about Torres?
So impressed with him for Spain and the other evening.
That's no good to us in FPL, though.
I know, but equally it shows you that he is in good form, because I think one of the things we were concerned about was obviously he's had a couple of benchings with Pep lately, and that puts you on the back foot. And with other players coming back to the fore, with the likes of Foden, who we've talked about a lot, coming back into the team, you worry about where he's going to play. I would struggle to budget for Torres right now because of the rotation risk with the others coming back.
Yeah, the problem as well, isn't it? He started the first four, I then signed him, and he hasn't played a minute since then. That's the concern, isn't it?
It is, yeah. Not worth the stress, in my opinion, Torres. There's so many other good options in that bracket. And he did go off on the 48th minute, I think, in that Nations League game. So just, I think he's OK, but just keep an eye on that.
Yeah, they had ice on his leg afterwards. Mm.
Yeah.
You don't know what that's going to mean. Is he going to play on Sunday in the final? I just think he's been so exceptional, again, in that Spain game.
He was great.
As a centre-forward, or false nine, whatever you want to call it, that maybe he's going to force his way back into the thinking, but... What do I know? What do I know?
In on your wild card then, James, yes? Torres.
Yeah, absolutely. All right, let's have a look at the next question, which is from C&G. Which do you think offers better value, double City defence or double Chelsea? Ooh. Great question.
I would go double City defence, actually, because I think, as I mentioned earlier on in the show, the way that they are defending right now, the stats that they're posting defensively, City, are so good, it's unreal.
Which two?
If I was going to go into the two, I'd have one risk and one that's not a risk. So right. Diaz, I don't think, is a risk. I think you're pretty safe with him at, I think, maybe 6.1 million. And then Cancelo, actually, who I've said a couple of times now, is a bit of a rotation risk on that side, but he's playing every week. So I don't see that as too much of a risk right now.
Sam, Chelsea or City?
For fear of being boring, I'm going to totally agree. I think I'd go Cancelo and Diaz and enjoy owning them both.
Brilliant.
Well, Patrick has been asking us about goalkeepers, asked whether he should play Sanchez or Ramsdale. Only 0.1 difference. Ramsdale has obviously burst onto the scene since signing for Arsenal. Looks like he's the number one now. Lee, which one of these two would you go for?
I think I'd go Ramsdale. I think Sanchez got a nice fixture this week against Norwich, isn't he? But then a couple of difficult ones. So I think I'd go Ramsdale. Looks as if he's locked down that spot at Arsenal now. What I would do is, if I was on a wild card, I'd pair him with Ben Foster at 4.0. So that if Ramsdale, for whatever reason, does get rotated and Leno comes in, Foster's coming in for you from Watford.
You're going to be boring and agree?
No, I wouldn't have either. I'd go Raya at Brentford. Simple.
Oh, yeah, we saw your wildcard drop. Yeah. All right, next question comes from McCarthy. It's a McCarthy inquiry. He says, if you were to choose between Ben White and Kieran Tierney, plus 0.5 more, who would you go for, Lee?
That's a tough one, isn't it? Mm. I mean, Kieran Tierney does give you that little bit extra going forward, but I fear with him a little bit, the injury record. That's my challenge with Tierney, is that he doesn't seem to be able to get that run in the team, that consistency. So I think I would go for Ben White at 4-4 and just know that you're going to get, the 6-pointer most weeks.
Yep, Ben White.
All right.
This next tweet comes from Blazer and said, should I get Trent now or just wait until after the Manchester fixture in game week 9? Of course, Watford are next up, as we've been talking. That's Manchester United, by the way, not Manchester City. What do you think, Sam?
Yeah, and as Lee mentioned earlier, Watford are particularly bad at dealing with set pieces, which, of course, we know Trent is going to be on. But I don't have Trent at the moment. I'm doing the Trent hokey-cokey. I took him out last week with a plan to bring him back in this week, as long as he is fit and available. So right. I'm waiting for confirmation that he's fit. If he's fit, bring him back now.
Lee, you're the Liverpool expert here. Should we be reinvesting in Trent, or is there a fitness issue there?
No, absolutely get him. I think there was some rhetoric when before the international break, before last game week, where I think Klopp is expecting to have him and Thiago back for game week 8. So keep an eye on the news. Obviously, he might be wrong, I might be wrong. But if we get any sort of hint that he's going to be fit, then yeah, get him.